Hey, screenwriters, you're tuned in to the Write On podcast from Final Draft. I'm Shani Edwards. Before I chat with the screenwriter of Challengers, a quick word about Final Draft's Big Break screenwriting contest. Big Break is now open for entries and has been launching careers for over 20 years. You can share in over $80,000 in cash and prizes, including a trip to Hollywood for meetings with reps and executives. Visit finaldraft.com to learn more. Now let's get to the show. In this episode, I talk with Justin Kuritzkes, writer of the new psychosexual sports film Challengers, starring Zendaya. We discuss the erotic power of tennis and how it naturally sets up the love triangle at the center of the story. Justin also tells me how watching classic boxing films helped him with the screenplay and discusses the challenges he faced going from playwright to screenwriter. Let's start the show. Hello, Justin. Welcome to the podcast. It's so great to have you.
Thank you so much. It's so good to be here.
So we're going to talk about the film Challengers, which I love. They're calling it the psychosexual sports movie, which is great. But I read that you grew up in the San Fernando Valley, as did I.
Oh, no kidding. Yeah. I'm in Encino.
Okay, great. I was more Burbank area.
Yeah.
The Valley's known for a lot of things, not really playwriting. So tell me how you got involved in theater and playwriting and how that happened for you in the Valley.
Well, I grew up, you know, I went to school in the Valley, and there was at a place called Harvard Westlake, and there was a playwrights festival that they would do at the school every year, where students would write short plays and then other students would put them on. And so I really started writing plays for that. I probably wouldn't have started writing plays otherwise, you know, and that was really where I fell in love with theater, was through doing that.
Well, that's great. I would imagine that there was a bit of a transition going from writing plays to writing your screenplay. I wonder what that was like for you.
Yeah, I mean, there is, I think, well, there are some things that are very similar, which is that who you are as a storyteller and the kind of characters that excite you or the kind of situations that excite you or that you find particularly dramatic or worth putting in front of people for a few hours, that's all pretty similar. And so I had a pretty firm sense of that. But what I found to be true about screenplays is that they're a very rigid, formalized way of writing. You know, in a play, for example, there's a standard format that you're supposed to use according to somebody.
Right.
But playwrights don't. No playwright actually follows that. You know, if you read 10 plays by 10 different playwrights that you love and admire, all their plays are going to look different on the page. Mm-hmm. There's no sort of standardized way that dialogue is supposed to be introduced or stage directions are supposed to be introduced. So it's kind of every play teaches you how to read it, you know, and a screenplay to some extent teaches you how to read it, but you don't really have the same freedom to be that creative on the page, except in ways, in little pockets of creativity that you find within it.
Can you give me an example of a pocket of creativity that you found?
Yeah. Well, so with Challengers, something that I started doing early on in the process of writing the screenplay was that I was just writing out the word thwack as a way to transition between scenes, because so many transitions were happening on the crack of a racket, you know, or on tennis courts were sort of the way that I would transition from time to time, that there was a sort of sense that I had that there was like osmosis between tennis courts across different time periods. So a ball could fly from one court and take you into the past or into the future. And the way I would connect those scenes in the screenplay was that I would write thwack, and that's how we would know we were going somewhere. And even just doing that, then that became a sort of rhythmic thing that became informative for me as I was writing it, in terms of visualizing what the energy of a scene would feel like. You know, if I wanted a rally to go a particular way, I would write out exactly the number of thwacks that would have to be there in order for it to communicate to the reader the energy and the amount of time we were spending somewhere. You know, it was a kind of like percussive or musical thing.
Yeah, it's very rhythmic. I'm very inspired by this.
Yeah. So, and that I think has a real correlation to theater, because that's how a lot of plays look. You know, there's a lot of sort of evocative stage directions as opposed to prescriptive stage directions. Mm-hmm. You know, stage directions that are meant to tell you how a transition feels, as opposed to telling you how to do it.
Sure. Or how it should look.
or how it should look. Yeah, right. That there's a sort of sense that I'm giving you an invitation to respond to this feeling, you know, or this vibe, more than I'm saying like light reduces by 50% and then whatever it is. So I tried to bring some of that into writing a screenplay. Yeah, which I found helpful.
That's great. Are you hooked now? Will you go back to plays, or are you now all in on screenplays?
I'm having a lot of fun writing screenplays, you know, especially when they get to be made like this one.
Yeah, that's the most fun, of course.
Yeah, people like this, you know, that's really fun. I think film sets are addicting. It's a really sort of intoxicating thing to be around film production. You know, I was really like, I think especially because so much of your life as a writer happens in a room alone, that there's something oddly thrilling about being in an office, you know, which is something that most people experience every day. But for me, there's still novelty to that. So like showing up to a production office and having a desk at the office, there was something about that that just made me feel really enlivened and energized. It's hard to think about going back to a world where I don't have that, you know?
Yes. And to have someone as beautiful, charismatic, and talented as Zendaya starring in your film is also probably addictive. How did she get to be producer on it?
Well, she read the script because, you know, after I had written it and given it to Amy Pascal and decided to work with her and Rachel O'Connor, one of the first conversations we had was that we need to send the script to Zendaya because it's really hard to imagine anybody besides her as this character. They sent it to her, she read it, and then we spoke on Zoom pretty soon after that. And I was, you know, incredibly excited that she wanted to not only be in it, but produce it. That was so, so amazing.
It's great. And the film turned out so good. And she really drives so much of the action and the plot and the story. So let's talk about writing challengers. Speaking of playwriting, it did kind of have threads from Harold Pinter's Betrayal a little bit, that love triangle thing. There were sort of shades of Y tu mamá también, a movie I love. So it was really fun to play around or get to see you guys play around with this idea of this love triangle. But for me, it was a little bit more complicated in that. It's more of a love square if you think of tennis. Yeah. As one of the participants in this relationship. How did you see tennis? Did you see it as its own character? And why tennis?
Why tennis is because that's where the inspiration for the movie came from in the first place, was, you know, watching this match with Serena Williams and Naomi Osaka at the 2018 US Open final, where Serena Williams got penalized for receiving coaching from the sidelines. And she was really upset and said, I didn't do that, that I would never do that. But I had never heard of that rule before, but immediately it struck me as intensely cinematic, you know, that you're all alone and there's this one person who cares as much about what happens to you as you do, but you can't talk to them. And what if you had to talk about something really important and not just about sports, you know, but about your lives? And what if it involved the person on the other side of the net? How would you have that conversation? So that all sort of came to me pretty early on when I was thinking about the movie. But I think generally tennis is a sort of amazing sport to think about a love triangle because it's so deeply charged erotically, tennis. You know, it's a game that's so seeped in repression, but also in kind of wild abandon. There's all these very rigid rules and prescriptions of movement and boxes that the ball has to fall into. And, you know, it's all so tightly organized. And yet, once the ball is in play, physics takes over and it's this wild chaos where you see these two people responding to each other in an almost instinctual, subconscious way. And so that there felt like there was a lot of energy in tennis that was exciting to me cinematically. You know, and I think when it comes to tennis being a character in the movie, I love the way you put that, because I think of the tennis court as the place where these people can talk to each other honestly without words. There's something that they can't get from each other outside of the court, you know, that they can't get from each other when they're not playing. And in a way, they can be their truest selves in tennis and they can have their deepest conversations through tennis. Yeah, that all sort of came of a piece when I was starting to think about the movie. And I tried to just stay true to that impulse as I was writing it.
Was the love triangle or love square, whatever you want to call it, was that immediate in your mind when you created these three characters? Did you know that they were going to be involved with each other on all of these different levels?
I didn't know all of it, but I knew that there was something going on with the three of them, because the movie sort of presented itself to me as this geometry between the three of them. You know, I sort of saw these three people on this court looking at each other like what was happening was really significant and like there was a lot at stake for them personally. You know, I knew that I wanted the stakes of the movie to not be the stakes of the match, to not be the official stakes of the match. So I knew that. And naturally, that leads you to it being about what's going on with them romantically, you know, or yeah. So I think that sort of all came together. But then, of course, there are surprises along the way as you're writing it. I didn't know exactly the dynamics or exactly the sort of movements in their lives. But I knew where we were going to meet them, and I knew something about where they were going to end up. And that was kind of how it happened.
I love that they're all very young. It's has such a youthful tone in the film. And that's innately sexual because of hormones and just where you're at that time of your life. And I loved going into their world and seeing how it played out on the court and obviously off the court.
Yeah.
You created these two characters. You have Art and Patrick. Now, in some ways, they are two sides of the same coin because they are connected. But in other ways, they're very different. When you set out to write and distinguish the two characters, how did you know to make Arts a certain way and Patrick a certain way?
I don't really know. I mean, I was thinking about I knew that Art and Patrick both had different strengths and weaknesses and different entitlements and hangups they were each hampered in some way from being their best selves, both on the tennis court and in life. And I knew that Tashi, to some extent, had what both of them were missing. Mm. You know, that there was in Tashi's game and in Tashi's outlook, you know, and in Tashi's way of moving through the world, she'd sort of reconciled these two things that these guys didn't have. That, you know, the thing that each guy was envious of in the other, she had them both. And I knew that that was all taken away from her, you know, and that that was what was going to animate all of their relationships together. In terms of like how Patrick or how Art came about, it's hard to say exactly where those characters come from. It's kind of like once a character shows up and is the character, there's no before, you know, they're there.
And they start talking to you.
And they start talking. Yeah. And then, and you listen.
Yeah. Okay. That's great. Now that makes a lot of sense, actually. When you're really in it, the characters kind of create themselves, I suppose, is what.
Yeah. Well, that's when writing is fun. Yeah. Is when you feel like you've gotten them talking.
When is writing not fun for you?
It's always, I mean, you know, I think it's not fun to be stuck on something. It's not fun to feel like you're trying to force something to happen. It's fun when you feel like when something clicks. It's hard in retrospect to like, I think a lot of writers have this where you kind of forget what it was like. Mm-hmm. You know, you block out what it was like.
Like childbirth. You forget the pain.
Yeah, you block it out a bit. And then you're starting a next thing and you know that you've gotten over whatever this is, whatever this horrible feeling is, but you don't remember quite how, you know?
Okay, well, you can claim amnesia for this next question, but is there a scene or a moment or a part of the story that was really challenging for you that maybe took you some time and frustration to get right?
Well, the tennis stuff required a lot of research and it was very labor intensive, you know, making sure that the match itself was dynamic and that it felt like there were movements in it, you know, and that it felt like it was, you know, there was a balance of making it feel like legit tennis and being true to that and making the drama of it unfold according to the rules of real tennis, you know, but then also not getting a reader or getting myself bogged down in that. And that took a lot of calibrating.
Did you take tennis lessons? Did you read screenplays about tennis? How did you know what words to use to describe the tennis on the page?
I read a lot of tennis books and I watched a lot of real tennis. Then I watched a lot of documentaries about tennis. I listened to interviews with tennis players. I did that. You know, I spent a lot of time on the ATP website, you know, like looking up where tournaments happen, how many ranking points you get for a tournament, all of that sort of stuff.
That's great.
There was a moment where I knew I like had internalized exactly how much money every top player had made in their career, you know, and I knew exactly how much money and how many ranking points each of these tournaments pay out, because I knew that that was going to be really important to my characters. So it became really important to me.
There's a line in the film that Tashi says, and it's such a, I thought it was a stroke of genius. In a way, it's simple, but it's just terrific. And as a playwright, you know, you usually get pretty experienced writing dialogue. And a lot of times in a screenplay, you have to pull back your dialogue, unless you're Aaron Sorkin, right? One of the guys says to her, you know, he's not in love with you. And Tashi says, what makes you think I want someone to be in love with me? And like, maybe that's true. Maybe she doesn't want that. Maybe she does want that. There was just such an air of mystery in that dialogue. And suddenly you think you understand her, but then all of a sudden she pulls that away. Maybe tell me about that line, that scene. I loved that.
Oh, thank you. That really means a lot that made you feel like that. That scene was really fun to write. I remember it coming very quickly, that scene, because what Art was after and how she was reacting to it were very clear to me. You know, I think so much of sort of the empathy I have for Tashi is around this interplay of her strength and her projection of strength and her sort of investment in her own strength and her own declaration that she doesn't need anything from anybody, you know, and then the moments where that proves to be untrue, the moments where in spite of herself, that proves to be untrue. And then the resentment she feels for that feeling within herself, you know, the way that realizing she needs something from these guys makes her furious.
It's almost a masculine quality to me. Like, cause I, and this is a stereotype, but you think of men as wanting to control women and their relationships sometimes. And, but she's really wants to be the master of all of her relationships. That's just an interpretation. I don't know if that's true.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, Tashi is very invested in being sort of the, master of her own destiny, but then the circumstances of her life lead her to a place where what her whole life had been building up to is taken away from her. And in a way it's a freak accident, but in another way, you know, what's kind of exceptional about tennis, by exceptional, I mean like strange, what's strange about tennis. It's one of the only sports where if you get injured, it's always your fault. Oh. Right? In boxing, if somebody punches you in the face and breaks your nose, maybe it's your fault for not dodging, but you can still go, that guy broke my nose. But in tennis, you either they tricked you or you tricked yourself. And that's why your body disobeyed your mind. And that's how you got hurt, right? So whenever you see a tennis injury, it's always because of something that's going on in somebody's head. You know, it's always because of a miscalculation or because of a moment of your mind being elsewhere. You know, or a moment where somebody outsmarted you in such a way that your body literally disobeyed you. So I think there's a sort of like deep fairness to that, but also a really like brutal unfairness to that. And I think Tashi's dealing with a lot of that stuff.
Absolutely. And it's a metaphor for relationships too, because like you said, in some ways, you could say, oh, well, he did this to me and he cheated on me, whatever. But it's always your own error. You can always blame yourself.
Well, it's part of taking responsibility for your life, you know, that you can only, of course, other people do things to you, but you're always, you know, you're always the only one living your life.
Right.
Which I think all these characters are dealing with in some way or another, that sort of crisis around ownership of themselves.
Yes. Now, you went back and forth in time a lot in the screenplay. I love how you said you used thwack, that image of that ball that can take you forward and backward in time. It's just a brilliant way to go back and forth. How did you know what time periods you wanted to go to and when? Did you write out a timeline? Was there a structure? Did you use note cards? I'm just curious in the mechanics of how you structured the screenplay.
I'm pretty chaotic. Like there's notes in my notes app. There's notes on sticky notes. It's all over the place. So yeah, I don't have any system. I knew that the timeline of the movie was the timeline of the movie because it occurred to me that the lifespan of an athlete is so short. You know, if you look at an athletic career as a little container of a life, it's a mini life. You can only really get started once you're 18 and you're done in your 30s, usually, if you're lucky. It felt natural to me that if you're going to tell a story about tennis players, it should be a story that's completely contained within those years. And that would almost feel like that's a cradle to grave story because that's the cradle to grave of their careers.
I love that.
Yeah. So I didn't know exactly when I was, you know, when I started, I didn't know exactly when I was going to go where, but I knew that it was going to take us through that time period.
Because this is a sports movie, were there other sports movies that you looked at to help you? I know you got, you did the deep dive into tennis, but were there actual sports films that helped you?
Of course. You know, I think weirdly, because boxing movies are so good, we usually think of them as being separate from sports movies. We don't really talk about boxing movies like they're sports movies, but of course they are sports movies. And in a way, boxing has the closest correlation to something like tennis. You know, tennis is boxing, but with rackets. And the difference is that in boxing, you're trying to make contact, and in tennis, you're trying to avoid contact. And that speaks to, I think, the difference in those two sports and the different psychological space that a movie about boxing versus a movie about tennis places the viewer in. So I was watching a lot of, you know, all of the same great boxing movies that people love. I was watching Raging Bull and The Fighter and Rocky and all those kinds of movies. I think the latest Creed movie is a fantastic boxing movie, like a great boxing movie. I was, in terms of like the world of sports and the kind of the way I wanted the relationship of the movie to it, to the stakes of the match, I was thinking about movies like Bull Durham, you know, which is set in the minor leagues, and He Got Game was a big influence, you know, which is a movie that's all building towards this pickup, not pickup, this game of one-on-one, where anybody walking by that park or that, you know, that concrete place where it's happening, nobody would know what's at stake. You know, nobody would think it's anything other than two guys playing one-on-one. But if you know the stakes of that match, you know that it's more important than the NBA finals. And so that was very inspiring to me. Also, that movie is just so good at constructing the world of a basketball player's life and all of the different sort of influences, good and bad, that are, and pressures and, you know, and enticements and all of that. Like it's such a, that movie's so brilliant at painting the whole ecosystem around basketball, you know, that it's almost about everything besides basketball, but using basketball as a way in. So I was very inspired by stuff like that.
Absolutely. I love that you used boxing as sort of this metaphor for tennis. It's because individual sports are very different than team sports, because usually the team sports movie seems like they have this sort of set structure where the team has to fall apart and then the team has to come together. But this is a little bit different. I loved the grittiness of sort of this, the challenger circuit about not having a place to sleep and looking for food. And like, it's just not a world that you get to see in film. What attracted you to that as opposed to making, you know, someone doing a film about someone like Serena Williams?
Well, I think it's, in one way, it's easier to imagine, it's easier for an audience and for me to imagine myself in the life of a tennis player who's slumming it, you know, who's really living from tournament to tournament and from paycheck to paycheck. I can't really connect with the guy who's center court at Wimbledon, you know,
right.
But I can connect with the guy who's just hoping that he gets an advance payment so he can pay the hotel. I think coming from theater, that was really, I felt a connection to it there too, because I probably, Patrick in the movie is ranked 271 in the world. So that means he's the 271st most successful tennis player at that moment, right? I probably know the 271st most successful actor in American theater, right?
Right.
I probably have been the 271st most successful playwright.
Right.
At some point in my life. And I know what that looks like. And it's not glamorous. It's you're broke and people don't know who you are. And you're you're practicing your craft at a high level and, you know, you're dedicating your life to it just as much as the person who's ranked number one is. But because you're not in that exact, you know, really teeny box where you can have tremendous success, it's as if you're ranked, you know, a 1 million in the world. You know, the distance is so vast. And so I think that world of sports was really interesting to me because that felt like the world that doesn't end up on the screen. You know, that's not the world that most people who like tennis think about. You know, even tennis fans aren't that interested in that world.
Sure.
So yeah, that's where that came from.
I love that. Seeing that, it was a surprise to me. I mean, it makes complete sense that, yeah, it's a struggle, but you, like I said, you just don't get to see it that often. There's one scene that I want to ask you about, and that's between Art and Patrick when they're in the sauna.
Yeah.
And their relationship is very, on one hand, you could say it's very codependent. On another end, you could say it's homoerotic. Did you write that scene in the sauna, or did your fabulous director, Luca Guadagnino, add that? I'm just curious.
No, that scene was always in the sauna. And that dynamic was always a part of their relationship. I mean, these guys have known each other since they were kids, and they've gone through puberty together, and they've spent their lives in locker rooms and in saunas and showers and on the courts together. Mm-hmm. And there's an erotic charge to any intimate friendship, but especially one that's built around sports and an individual sport, you know, because I think there's a deep intimate knowledge you have about somebody who you've been playing against your whole life. So that thread of it was always in the script, but Luca brought a lot of his vision to that. And I think it got amplified and enriched by a collaboration with Luca, definitely.
What I loved about that quality of the film is that I think this erotic charge that you spoke of really does exist between a lot of young men, and it's just not really ever talked about. And how can it not? Again, you're young, there's hormones, there's everything. And I thought it was very brave to kind of explore that area of the triangle, you know, and of the relationship. I'm wondering how it feels to see that part of it on screen.
I think it makes the film a lot more interesting. I think it's played so delicately and with so much truth by the actors, you know, and orchestrated so delicately by Luca. You know, I think there's something that feels very real to me about the way that those guys relate to each other and the way that those guys are tied up in each other's intimate lives. It always felt to me watching tennis like that's right on the bubbling right under the surface of it, you know, that you'd have to really be trying not to see it. So I'm really happy with the way it exists in the film.
So exciting and interesting to me. What are you going to be doing next? Because I know everybody is really curious. You're also married to the fabulously talented Celine Song. Are you guys going to do a movie together, or do you want to keep your creative life separate, or what? I'll let you explain where you're going next.
We like to keep our creative lives separate so that we can support each other as fully as we have been. You know, we very supportive of each other, very proud of each other. You know, it's been so spectacular to see Celine's movie have the life that it had, mm-hmm. and for people all over the place to, you know, recognize this person who I love as this great artist, which mm-hmm. is something I've known forever. That's been you can imagine that's been really gratifying. In terms of what I'm doing next, I've got another movie that I wrote for Luca called Queer, which we shot last year, which is with Daniel Craig and Drew Starkey. And it's an adaptation of a book by William S. Burroughs. I don't have information about when that's being released or anything, but that's kind of the next thing I did. And then there's other stuff I'm working on that I can't say much about.
Of course.
Yeah.
I wonder what advice you have for someone who is currently a playwright. They're trying to redefine how they execute their story for the screen. What piece of advice would you have for that person?
It's really useful to have some knowledge of yourself as a dramatist or as a storyteller before you go into writing a screenplay because screenplays are so unforgiving. And so I think if you've already been working as a playwright or a novelist or something, you've got an advantage there. I think the main thing I was focusing on as I was writing Challengers was that I really wanted to feel like I could see the movie on the page because it was a movie I really wanted to watch. And so I wasn't really writing the movie thinking about what anybody else was going to think about or, you know, think about it or want from it. I was really just trying to make this movie exist that I wanted to exist for me. And that's kind of all you can go on. You know, you can't tell if something is good as you're writing it. And you can't tell if something is like going to be a safe bet for anybody to make. All you can tell is whether the movie is alive to you. And if that's true, there is a chance that the movie will be alive on the page to other people to the point where they'll want to make it with you. That's all you can do.
I think that's great advice. The last thing I want to ask you about is, as I was researching you, I came across the potion seller video on YouTube, so which is a lot of fun. So do you still have a career making videos for YouTube? Will we see more videos coming from you?
I think a career is a stretch. YouTube is, for me, YouTube is a great career for some people.
It is.
It was never a career for me. It was really just, I sort of think of it as an ongoing performance project that I've been doing since I was, you know, 20, and that I hope to keep doing it whenever I feel like it for as long as I want. I'm very happy to have those continue to be a part of my life. And I'm always surprised when people who I meet in other corners of my life have seen those things and want to talk about them.
Can you end this interview as the potion seller?
Oh, God. No, you can go watch the video. It's online.
Fair enough. Okay.
I can send you the link for it if you want. No, yeah. But I'm happy that the videos did something for you.
Well, thank you, Justin. It's been an absolute pleasure chatting with you. I wish you the best of luck with this film, and hopefully I'll get to talk to you when Queer comes out.
I hope so, too. Thank you so much.
All right. Take care. Thanks for listening to this episode of Right On. Challengers opens wide on April 26th. As always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review. If you haven't already, subscribe to our show on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook. Follow us on X at Final Draft Inc. and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Final Draft and Shaney Edwards. Editing is by Grand Slam Tennis Ace Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. And until next time, right on.